Everyone, and welcome back to the second lecture in series of lectures where I'm going to talk about the new industry standard gallium nitride transistor model. And maybe I just review a little bit of what we discussed yesterday. So we started from gallium nitride device basics. How does the device work? Where is the source of two-dimensional electron gas density? And how do you control the two-dimensional electron gas density? And how do you basically make it as a transistor? And then we reached a point where we know how to we reviewed the fabrication steps, and we know how to make the device. Now we want to use the device in applications. Applications can be power converters, applications can be wireless communication, power amplifiers, or whatever that may be. But the point is that to use the device optimally in right way, in time and cost efficient manner, you have to have infrastructure to simulate very accurately. And then we figured out that for that type of simulations, there are many types of device models which are possible. You may have measurement-based models, you may have empirical models, you may have neural network-based models, you may have very very detailed three-dimensional TCAD models, and all of them have advantages, disadvantages. Then we kind of reached a point where we realized that there are all these trade-offs in different types of models, and to get the best performance, and actually the need, which is circuit simulation, physics-based compact models look very promising, and which has been the case for not just gallium nitride but for many semiconductor technologies over long period of time. For silicon-based, it is BSIM, PSP, EKV models, which are physics-based models, and they are primarily used to design very complex silicon circuits. And similarly, for other semiconductor, even for gallium arsenide, people do prefer physics-based compact models to design circuits. And the reason is, we discussed this slide yesterday, is that there are requirements about model speed. There are requirements about model predictability, requirements about model robustness. Now, that is robustness meaning in different types of circuit simulation, will it lead to convergence or it will lead to failure? And then there is, of course, accuracy requirement. And this kind of a chart shows you that if you have a very complex TCAD model that has excellent predictability and accuracy, but it really suffers poorly for the speed and for the robustness. Similarly, if you have on the other extreme measurement or empirical model, it does very well for speed and to a certain extent okay for robustness, but it really suffers for accuracy and predictability. And therefore, we figured out that physics-based compact models are a very kind of strike the right balance to do circuit design. And the model which I'm going to talk about is a physics-based compact model. Then we started a little bit discussion on what are the components of physics-based compact models, what do we need to build it, and this is where we kind of finished our lecture. So I talked about that there are you can say three different, more or less distinct components. First one is a core model. And now this slide is actually not specific to gallium nitride transistor model. This, you can say, is general. Most of the physics-based compact models will have this distinction, whether it is BSIM model or EKV model or PSP model for silicon or ASM model for gallium nitride, right? These three components you can see in them, which are more or less very distinct. First is core model. Core model means, so transistor operation is kind of like this. You apply the gate voltage, You create the charge and then you transport that charge. Create the charge, transport the charge. So to figure out how much is the current, you first need to know how much is the charge. That is this charge in the channel. And then that charge in the channel gets transported by certain other physics. It can be a drift diffusion transport, it can be a ballistic transport, it can be a tunneling. For example, the newer transistor technology, which is tunnel field effect transistors, TFETs, there the transport mechanism is just tunneling. Yeah, but the point is that you create a charge and then you transport that charge. So that becomes core model. Now in deriving this, in deriving equations or developing models for this core, you have to make certain simplifying assumptions about the device. Even for silicon, which has been studied for so long, and you know, there are so many papers and people have understood the device so well, even there you have to make certain simplifying approximations. And the reason is that you don't want to complicate the model too much, where you suffer in terms of either speed or in terms of robustness of convergence. For example, it is even now for silicon device, it is very hard to model from source to drain if there is a doping variation, spatial variation in doping, which can happen actually in manufacturing. It's very hard to develop an analytical model for that. So analytical models are going to assume that doping is constant. Yeah, so that would mean that simplifies the thing, but still doesn't take away all the physics out of the device. Yeah, but that would mean that there are many real device effects which have to be accounted for, which have to be somehow incorporated in the model, right? Then there are certain resistances, the contacts which are made to the device, drain or source contact, will always have some resistive effects, which also needs to be incorporated in the model. So this type of component, which is not really dealt with in core model, becomes second component for a physics-based compact model. There are many, many real device effects, and we will get into real device effects of GaN transistor in this course, which have to be accounted in the model. So that's another component. And then third is about the different types of simulation needs for circuit design. So you don't just want to know what is the drain current, right? You want to know what is the noise performance. You want to know what is the variability, manufacturing variation performance, and these type of more advanced simulation needs for circuits. So that overall, this three component, this distinct component, then become a physics-based compact model. So this brings me to outline of today's lecture. So what I will talk about is the ASM model, which stands for Advanced Spice Model for HEMTs. This is a newly accepted industry standard model for gallium nitride power and RF devices. So industry standardization itself is like a stage-wise process. So there is a standardization body which, based on publication, will invite universities to participate in the process. And then that process goes on with stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4, and at every stage there are a lot of rigorous quality requirements, rigorous accuracy and robustness requirements which one needs to satisfy. Then people vote, the member companies will vote on the models, that this one is good or this one is bad, and then through that process is what they select industry standard model. So this model has been recently, you know, have gone through all the stages of the process and has been selected as an industry standard model. So what I will talk about is overview of this model from a user perspective, and then from, you know, the different components, and going a little more on into detail of those components. So in the components, there is the current model and then the charge model, right? So the core of the current and core of the charge model. The charge model is also the terminal charges is what gives you capacitances of the device. So this is a little bit of a this is a little bit of a concept which is more known in device community, which is much more, you know, understood in simulation and device communities rather than in in circuits or application or circuit designer community. So I will show some simple examples where actually you will see that why this is really critical, especially for convergence of circuits. And then I will just, in today's lecture, I'll just introduce the real device effects. So this is where we will end today's lecture. In the next one, we will cover all the real device effects, and the last one will cover parameter extraction procedure for this model. So that's the plan. So starting with overview of GaN RF, this is kind of like a picture from a user perspective who doesn't really know, or to an extent doesn't really care what is ASM model. So as far as user is concerned, you can think about it as, you know, a black box, and you supply the bias voltages and temperature, and you supply the model parameters, and what you get out of it are terminal currents, capacitances, non-linearity, noise, and other types of characteristics of the device, right? So it's, you can think of it like a black box if you don't really want to get into the details of, you know, what are the core equations and what do they represent and all of this. You just want to use it to simulate. Then this is what you need to supply, this one, and then you get out all of these properties of the device. Yeah. So bias and temperature are clear. This is just the input voltages and ambient temperature in which you want to simulate the circuit. Parameters are a little bit more involved. So parameters are what specific to the device which you want to simulate. So even GaN device from different manufacturer, if you make device in your lab versus someone else makes in lab in US, they are not going to be exactly same devices, right? We talked about that GaN thickness may be different, you may have a different channel length, you may have a different channel width, and several things may be different, right? So those are accounted for in the model in form of parameters, and there are parameters can be classified into three categories. First is device geometry parameters. So this is just the dimensional information of different features of the device, like the channel length, width, if you have more number of fingers, what is the barrier layer thickness, and in GaN device you also have a distance from gate to the drain contact and gate to the source contact, so that length of that region. All of these parameters are, if you know about the device, if you are, let's say for example, making it yourself, or you have this information from the device manufacturer, then you just use those numbers right away in the model. You just put what is L, what is W, what is NF, what is excess regionalization, and that's it. So these are device geometry parameters. Then there are parameters which are related to specific effects happening in the device. So for these parameters, you have to actually extract them after measuring the device. Yeah, so you measure IV characteristics or CV characteristics of the device, and from different regions of these measurements and different types of these measurements, you extract parameters which are related to that specific effect. So for example, mobility is really important in IV characteristics. You extract the mobility from IV characteristics. Yeah, capacitance related parameters are extracted from CV characteristics. We extract them from CV. So the extraction flow is, we will get into the extraction flow in more detail in the last lecture of this series. And there are many physical effects, saturation velocity, effect because of drain electric field, and pinch off or cutoff voltage, and few more, right? So all of these parameters need to be extracted by measuring the device, by doing electrical characterization of the device which you want to use in your circuit. Then there are few other parameters which are actually related to smoothening. Now these are these you do not really have to extract, because the default value should really work reasonably well, but at times you might need a little bit of tuning in these parameters if you are really after, you know, accuracy in certain regions of operation. Now, these parameters are important because these parameters exist in the model because, you know, like I said before, that analytical formulation or formulations which are computationally good, computationally useful, always will break down the device into regions. So in I will say that, okay, I'm going to only look at linear region, and in this region I can derive a very, very accurate and very simple, very highly computationally effective formulation. Then I can do that same in saturation region. But how do I transition between the two? So this is where, you know, the smoothening functions or the smoothening parameters will help. So in general, you have a very good formulation which you can actually derive in one region, another one in another region, and you have to kind of join them somehow in a smooth and continuous and mathematically robust manner. And that's the origin of these parameters. So typically, let's say from linear to saturation, that's if you imagine the IV curve, right? It increases and then it saturates. So this smooth transition from linear to saturation, how fast is that transition? How sharp is that transition is kind of controlled by this parameter. So typically they have set default values which should work reasonably well, but if you are after very high accuracy, then you might have to tune these parameters a little bit, right? So as a user, these are the three things, three things, bias, temperature and parameters is what you put into the model, and you get current and charges and capacitances and noise and other things from the model, right? So this is kind of like a user perspective. Now this is now getting into more detail into this model, that how and what physics is being used to calculate different parts, and how does the flow of the model is, what is being calculated first and then what comes next and what comes after that, like that. Yeah. So first, the two-dimensional electron gas quantum well, which we saw in the last lecture. First, the two-dimensional electron gas density needs to be calculated. That's the charge calculation part for this transistor, right? So that calculation needs consistent solution of Schrodinger's and Poisson's equation. Schrodinger's equation controls the energy levels, and then Poisson is just the electrostatics of the device. They are intercoupled, so that has to be solved self-consistently, and that gives 2 dB charge or Fermi level or surface potential. All of these three things are kind of related, so if you get one, you can get the other one reasonably well. So this solution gives you this part. So this is only calculating how much charge is in the channel. Now we need to kind of transport this charge to calculate the current, right? So that's carrier transport. So that's once you know the charge, then you apply this drift diffusion physics to calculate drain or gate current. So this involves mobility and velocity saturation, because this is how charges are transporting, right? If you have a small electric field, then the velocity with which charges move is V, is mu, which is mobility times the electric field. But as you keep on increasing electric field, the velocity saturates. So that all of that physics goes into these current calculations, which is based on drift diffusion carrier transport. So that gives you the drain current, which gives you IV. To get the capacitances, you also need to calculate the charges which are associated with each of the terminal. So when I apply 1 volt VG, how much is the gate charge? Yeah, when I apply 1 volt VG, 0.5 volt VD, 0.5 volt VS, how much are drain and source charges? All of the terminal charges, they need to be calculated. So those equations are again the charge model, and from the charge model you can get the capacitances between any of the two terminals, between gate and drain, between gate and source, between drain and source, and any other terminals. Yeah. Then On drain current and charge model, you also need to account for the series resistances and many other effects happening on the device. So all of this becomes the next step. So, and once you have done these two steps, you get accurate IV and CV characteristics of the transistor after extracting the associated parameters for each of the physical effect. Right. So this only gives you these two things, give you the drain current, give you the capacitances. But like I said, that there are a few more effects which to make the model, the term which people you may find people use is fully featured. Fully featured means it's not just current and capacitances, noise or, you know, non-linearity and all of those aspects can also be obtained from the model. So those are these, that noise is being implemented, trapping effects are accounted in the model, self-heating, which is just heating of the device because of the power being dissipated in the device, needs to be accounted for. So this whole package becomes the full model, and then you can do whatever type of simulation you want to do, either it is DC, AC or transient or harmonic balance or noise. And the development of this model has been in this programming language called Verilog AMS, which is a very popular language for development of compact models. It is popular mainly because of the fact that it is supported by multiple commercial simulators. So ADS or HSPICE or Cadence, also Mentor, AWR also to a certain extent. So you write your code in Verilog A and you can basically use any of these simulators to do to simulate the circuit which you want to simulate. So all of this kind of physics and all of these equations have gone into this big Verilog A code, which can be ported and which can be used to simulate circuits in, you know, multiple simulators. So now I will go into further details of this model, and like I said, that the full model consists of the core model and the real device effects. So core is the charge calculation and carrier transport. On top of this, you add all of these real device effects, kind of like a wrapper. So there is a piece of code which is calculating these charges and currents, which does not include all of these effects. And then on top of that, you keep adding these so many of these effects, which are important, which are happening in the device, right? So all of these range of effects are there in the model. And as we will go through the real device effects modeling, I will discuss each one of the effects and how they are implemented in the model in the next lecture. Yeah, so this is just a range of effects. Some of these effects happen in other semiconductor devices also. They are not really GaN specific. So for example, temperature dependence, whether it is silicon, whether it is GaN, there is some temp. Although the dependence itself is different, but silicon is also has some temperature dependence characteristics. GaN also has temperature. But some of the effects are actually specific to GaN. For example, this non-linear resistance. Because silicon is a device which is self-aligned between gate edge and drain, there is hardly any space, right? The drain starts right at that edge. Same thing for the source side. But GaN, if you remember from the picture, there is a space between gate edge and the point where source starts. That access region actually behaves like a, it is like a resistor, but it's like a non-linear resistor. You cannot simply model it by just putting a resistor there and thinking that it is a constant value resistor. It actually depends on the bias, and we will talk about that, right? So all of these effects, such as heating of the device, drain-induced barrier lowering, saturation, velocity saturation, trapping, all of these will be covered as we go along. If I look at this list and if I think of some of the, you know, few things which are very, very specific to GaN, this can be non-linear resistor. This is also configurable field plates. So in GaN transistor, people put these field plates in the device, and actually it can get fairly complex. Some people go as high as 4 field plates in the device. Yeah, you might not have seen such devices, but you know, field plates are kind of used to optimize the performance of the device. You can play around with field plate lengths and position their position to optimize what is the breakdown you get, what is the on resistance you get. And some manufacturers can go as high as 4 field plates. And 4 field plates, so field plate can be gate connected or it can be source connected. It can be connected to the source terminal of the device, or you just connect it to the gate. And now you can have several combinations. You can imagine that first one gate connected, second one source connected, third one gate connected, fourth one again source connected. You may have 2 gate connected and 2 source connected. You know, there are all these combinations. So the model needs to kind of account for those things, that you may be having a device where you have 2 gate connected and then 1 source connected, or other way, or there are so many combinations. So it has been built in a way that as a user, you can set it. You can tell the model that I have two source connected, then gate connected, and then another one source connected, or any other combination which you as a manufacturer has designed. Yeah. So all of these things are incorporated, and we'll go into more detail. So let's start with the core model calculations. So core, like I said, includes the charge and includes the transport of the charges, right? So we'll start with core. So core charge calculation is basically calculating the charge in this two-dimensional electron gas. So this is the picture we already saw from previous lecture. This is the picture of GaN device. And when we talk about core model, typically this is the region which we are trying to model, the region under the gate. People also referred this region as intrinsic region, intrinsic transistor. This region from this to this is considered to be extrinsic transistor. Yeah, because transistor action happens below the gate. Yeah, so when we talk about core charge calculation, we are talking about calculating the charges here. Al-GaN interface here, and this is the Venn diagram looking like this. So this is the gate, this is the Al-GaN layer, and this is GaN layer in which you have two-dimensional electron gas. Now, two-dimensional, so the amount of charge you have depends on where is the position of the Fermi level and where is the position of energy bands, E0, E1, like that, right? So ideally, you should include as many number of bands as possible, right? But you can clearly see that if you increase more and more number of bands, it increases complexity of the model very easily. Even for 2 band or 1 band, the solution is already very complex, because now this is actually not in typical cases, which is EF will be actually somewhere around here in silicon type devices, right? But here it is actually within conduction band, and there is quantization. Silicon, you can approximate it to not have quantization, and this makes physics more complicated, because the energy level themselves depend on how much is 2DEG, and 2DEG depends on where are energy levels relative to Fermi level. So it's an intercoupled relationship. And as you apply gate voltage, you move EF, you change 2DEG charge, and 2DEG charge in turn changes the energy levels, and therefore all of this system has to be solved kind of self-consistently. So this is what it can be kind of represented like this. So number of carriers in the energy bands, which is actually the 2DEG charge density, carriers in E0 and E1 and, you know, even higher levels energy bands, and device electrostatics. These two things are coupled. So if you have more number of carriers, you have more electric field, the shape of the triangular well is, you know, more sharper, more electric field, the well is sharper. If the sharper the well, it changes where are the energy levels, right? And therefore everything is coupled, and these equations kind of represent that this is my 2 dB charge density, this is Fermi level, which will be moved by the gate voltage, and these are energy levels. Now energy level themselves, they depend on NS. So this is a system of equation which you have to solve somehow to figure out how much is your 2 dB charge density, right? But the thing is that you cannot for a compact model, you cannot rely on numerical. You don't want a numerical solution. The reason being that numerical solutions are computationally expensive, and numerical solutions may not have that mathematical robustness for convergence in all types of circuit simulation. So you have to figure out a way to develop an analytical solution from these set of equations, right? So that is very hard because of these complex formulations of equation. And one of the way to tackle this problem is by dividing the variation of Fermi level or two-dimensional electron gas with the gate voltage into different regions, and try to figure out then in each of these regions, can I do an analytical model? So this is what basically happens in this model. This is what I worked some time back. So this is a numerical simulation actually. This is a numerical simulation of Fermi level, of first energy level, of second energy level as the gate voltage is being applied. Yeah, so you can see all of them move, and all of them are going to change amount of 2 dB charge which will happen at particular gate voltage, because that's what we are interested in. We want to know what is the 2 dB charge at this or whatever gate voltage, right? Because that's what gives us the current. So what we see is that we can identify kind of three regions: region 1, region 2, region 3. Region 1 is below the cutoff voltage of the device. So let's say minus 3 volt is the cutoff voltage of the device. Region 1 is below that. So the Fermi level is well below energy level. So there's very few electrons there, or the charge density is very small. Fermi level is well below the energy level, so the energy levels are kind of empty, and very few charges in this region. After the cutoff voltage, Fermi level becomes closer and closer to the first E0 or the first energy level, right? So therefore, that would mean that energy level has now been filled with some electrons. If you keep on applying gate voltage even more, there will be a point where Fermi level will actually cross the first one. Yeah. So these are three distinct regions. Below cutoff, you can say this one has moderate two-dimensional electron gas because Fermi level has not yet crossed E0, but it is closer to E0 as compared to the previous one. And then the third region where it has actually crossed E0 and there is a lot of charges, lot of two-dimensional electron gas density, right? So what happens is that complex physics which I showed you in previous slide, you can apply some clever ways to actually develop analytical solutions in each of these individual regions, right? If you fix on this one, you do some approximation, derive an analytical solution here, in the second one, in the third one, like this. So these are, you know, the analytical solutions for two-dimensional electron gas density in different regions, whether it is this one, but these regional solutions, they are not really a desirable solution for compact model. And the reason being that how would I write this code? So if I write this code, I have to write, okay, if this, then use this equation. If something else, then use this equation. If something else, then use this equation. That would mean that there is a discontinuity. If I'm running a transient simulation, right, I may reach a point where I have to, you know, kind of switch from that form of equation to the next one. that is not really desirable. Discontinuity means that the derivative at that point can be very large, very small, a weird number, right? That may lead to convergence problems. So this is okay, this is a starting point, but this is not really ideally ideal solution. So what needs to be done is you have to kind of join all of these, somehow join all of these regional solutions into a very smooth unified solution. All of these regional solutions into a very smooth unified solution which covers all these regions and still doesn't lose you, still doesn't hit you in terms of accuracy in all of these regions. So that's what basically happens in this model, is that all of these solutions are now combined into a unified solution which can go all the way from below cutoff voltage to above cutoff voltage without actually breaking down these equations into regions, right? So that's a basically clever way of combining these, joining these different regions. And lot of testing, lot of effort goes into making sure that this equation has you can take derivatives of this equation, several orders of derivatives of this equation, because if you think from let's say if you are an RF circuit designer, if you are designing a power amplifier and you are thinking about what is the linearity of your power amp, then linearity actually depends on third order derivative. If you are thinking about third order linearity, IM3, it depends on third order derivative. If third order derivative is not smooth, then all those results will be some junk results. Yeah, so, and nowadays linearity is becoming more and more important. People don't even just look at third order, but even fifth order linearity performance of power amplifiers. So one has to make sure that several orders of derivatives of the equations which we are using in model does give you smooth, does give you reasonable numbers. So that's what happens here. So it's just it has regional models are all mathematically, you know, combined into a smooth continuous derivative type function, which still doesn't hit you in terms of accuracy, but still preserves the regional approximations as you pass through different regions. So once you have this, then this is not very difficult, because like I said before, the two-dimensional electron gas density and Fermi level or surface potential are they are just related to each other. If you know one, you know the other one, right? So what happens is the accuracy requirement for especially for RF circuits, especially for harmonic balance type simulation, is very high. Is very, very high actually, and therefore from the previous model, if you do calculate surface potential, you may get accuracy of millivolts, which is the blue one which you see here, right? So then further efforts need to be put into, and typically they say that you should get an accuracy of nanovolts. That's the figure which you will hear from, you know, people who have been working in device modeling and developing surface potential models for a long time. So therefore, some more mathematics, some more improvement in terms of accuracy goes into these calculations, still trying to preserve that it is a equation which is unified, which is not regional, and can improve the accuracy. So which is what happens in this model also, and then ultimately what we were able to achieve is this type of accuracy, which is now femtovolts for all bias conditions, so well below cutoff voltage all the way to, you know, very high two-dimensional electron gas charge density. So this becomes a core model. This becomes a core surface potential or charge calculation, which is then used to do more stuff in the model. Right. So now what we have reached, we reached a point where now we can calculate how much is charge in the channel. We can calculate it very accurately. Right. What we did to do that is to solve Schrodinger and Poisson equation self-consistently, And it's only possible to do that by regional approximations. But then we figured out a way to basically combine it, combined all the regional models into a unified, smooth, continuous, and function which you can take many derivatives with, right? So that becomes you can say, if you are thinking about in terms of a software code, now these are the variables I calculate, I'm going to use them to calculate some more stuff, right? These are the variables, intermediate variables I have already calculated. Now I'm going to use this to calculate current, calculate capacitance, other things, right? So this is kind of like a one step done. Now we go to so we have calculated the charge. Now we are to calculate the current, we need to know how this charge transports. So that's the carrier transport. That's another type of that's another physics formulations, right? So if now that depends actually on typical size of your device. So for example, if your which is the case for gallium nitride, is relatively long. So the distinction comes from whether it is a ballistic transport or whether it is a drift diffusion dominated transport. These are two different mechanisms. So if the device is very, very small, extremely small, if the channel length is extremely small, maybe 20 nanometer or 15 nanometer, for which is what you have for silicon transistors these days, yeah, in that case the transport from source to drain, as the carrier goes from source to drain, yeah, since the channel length is so small, it may happen that it doesn't go through any scattering event. It just ballistically transports from source to drain. That's a different type of transport as compared to drift diffusion, where when the carrier travels, it bumps into different things, and then ultimately it has some velocity, some average velocity with which it transports. So there is a concept of mobility, which is actually telling you what is the average velocity after, you know, bumping around with different atoms during its transport. And there is a concept of ballistic transport. Ballistic happens in very, 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 very short channel length devices, which is the case for silicon transistors now. But for gallium nitride, it's relatively, it is very long channel as compared to silicon transistors, right? So for our case, the drift diffusion transport is what is needed, and which is what we do for ASM model. So the drain current has two components. One of them, this is called drift component, and the other one, this is called diffusion component. Now, this is in form of derivative. So this is current at a point, at any point in the channel, at any point x. So if you know surface potential, if you know the charge at that point and the derivatives of that, then you can calculate the current, right? But that's not really what we want. What we want is, we just want to know, if I apply VG, VD, how much is the current which is going to flow, right? So this equation is not really useful. So what is being done in many compact models is just to take this dx, the other side, and integrate it over the channel length. Integrate it from source to drain. So you get rid of the derivatives, and then you can get a current expression where now you see that you have channel width, which is a geometric parameter, channel length, which is a geometric parameter, mobility, which is a device parameter, the capacitance. This is the gate voltage minus the threshold or the cutoff voltage. This is average surface potential. This is thermal voltage. This is surface potential at the drain minus surface potential at the source. So this is surface potential based expression. Now surface potential is calculated from the previous core model which we discussed, right? So like I said, that you can think of it as kind of an intermediate variables I have calculated. Now I'm going to use these variables to do something else, right? So this is that. Drain current. So from the core model, we got surface potential, and by using this drift diffusion formulation, performing the integration, figuring out the final expression for the current, this is our current. Yeah. So this is core drain current formulation. Still, it doesn't include several of the real device effects which are actually needed. which are needed to get high accuracy in the model, right? So this is core drain current formulation, and it is based on first calculating the charges in the channel, which is related to surface potential. Yeah. Now, core drain current model, like I said, actually gives you the current for an ideal device. Ideal device is kind of like a imaginary device which will, you know, which you can think that it has zero series resistance, you know, mobility remains constant, mobility never changes even if you change the bias conditions, there are no traps, the device is, you know, perfect. And all of those things have to be assumed to actually derive analytical solution. There is no way that you can incorporate the imperfection into the core calculations. Already the physics is very complex, and you need to, you know, rely to several approximations and then some mathematics to actually derive a core calculation. If you try to include the imperfections, it becomes impossible to actually derive an analytical solution. Therefore, these assumptions are, you know, necessary. Assuming that it is idealistic is necessary. But what it preserves is the physics. That fine, even if there is this ideal device which is not really the device in your hand, but in terms of the bias variations, in terms of the scalability, it still preserves the physics which happens in the device, right? And therefore, on top of this idealistic core drain current model, you have to include all of these real device effects, all of these imperfections in the device which are there, which are needed to accurately model the data, right? So how do I verify this model? How do I verify that whatever I did for the core is good? Only way to do that is through those complex TCAD simulation, because I can make an ideal device there. I can make a device which is, you know, which has no imperfections. And that this is what I was showing you in the previous slides here, right? These are all very complex three-dimensional numerical simulations, because this is the only place where I can actually make an ideal device. Yeah. So the core calculations which we did have been verified with the three-dimensional simulations, where, you know, a device is divided into many, many parts, and it includes all those details, and all the physics is solved in so many grid points, and everything is self-consistent and all of that, right? So that simulation can easily take an hour if you are simulating many, many bias points, even more than an hour. This simulation, for example, here with the model which we derived, this will take few seconds. That is the difference. That is why we cannot really rely on such accurate three-dimensional simulation for circuit, right? You cannot wait an hour for simulating one bias point, right? This is now a mathematical equation. You just put in numbers and it will give you whatever you are trying to calculate. This is in seconds, not even seconds, right? So that's the big difference. This is why you actually need analytical compact models, as opposed to you already have three-dimensional models, but they are not useful for circuit simulations, right? So what we have reached at this point is now we can calculate the charges in an ideal device by solving self-consistently Schrodinger and Poisson equation, and we verify our calculation with three-dimensional, highly accurate first principle simulations, and see that yes, indeed they are very well, they align very well, and the model is accurate. And then we apply the carrier transport physics, which is drift diffusion in this case, to derive the expression for drain current of the device for an ideal device still. That verification is again can only be done with TCAD simulation, because that is the only way, that this is only where you will get ideal device. For silicon, it is actually slightly better, because silicon, the manufacturing process over so many years has evolved to a place where, you know, now the actual device is very, very close to an ideal device, the defects have been minimized to a very large extent. And therefore, in silicon case, even the core model can be seen that it won't give too bad an accuracy if you just compare that with real transistors, because real transistors have been optimized for so many years and they have really become very close to ideal. But for gallium nitride, it's just starting, right? So there are many imperfections in the device, and therefore there are several real device effects which have to be included. Yeah. So this is just a picture showing that once you account for the real device effects. So for example, this is the current versus gate voltage, and this is transconductance. So this is on the right side and this is on the left side, and this is the line is the model, and the symbols are the experimental data. So now this is not just the core model which we saw. This is actually a model which also includes different real device effects, and after that you get a good matching with the experiments. Right, so this kind of takes us to a point where we have now derived the current, the drain, the idealized transistor drain current for gallium nitride device. Right, so this is also considered to be a core model. Right, now on this core we are going to put, as the effects happen, we have to kind of model them and then keep updating this equation which we derived here, you know, keep changing this equation. The core formulation remains the same, but we keep adding stuff to it to account for series resistance, to account for mobility change, to account for any other effect which happens in the device, right? But the starting point is this two-dimensional electron gas calculation, and then drift diffusion calculation to calculate the current, right? But now the other piece of core is, of course, to calculate the terminal charges. This is needed for capacitances. So like I said, that when we talk about the core, we are talking about this region, which is also called as intrinsic region. So if this is your external source, you can say that this point here is an intrinsic source terminal, and this point here is intrinsic drain terminal, right? So I'm kind of taking out these access regions from gate to source and from gate to drain, and I'm only focusing on this part of the device, right? So now what we need to know is the capacitances, is to know this gate to source, this capacitance, CGG capacitance, CDS capacitance, all of that associated with the intrinsic part of the transistor. Yeah, so we need to know how much. So now this is where slight deviation happens, and slight different style of terminology is used typically in applications and circuits, as opposed to, you know, compact modeling or physics based compact models. So to calculate the capacitance at, let's say, between gate and source, or gate and drain, or gate to gate capacitance, all actually I need to calculate is charge associated with this terminal, charge associated with this terminal, charge associated with that terminal. If I know all of these three charges, QG, QS and QD, then I can calculate whatever capacitance is needed, because capacitance is dQG over dVG, that's CGG. Derivative of gate charge with respect to gate voltage is CGG. Derivative of gate charge with respect to source voltage is CGS. Derivative of gate charge with respect to drain voltage is CGD, right? So what I need to figure out is analytical expressions for gate charge, source charge and drain charge. Yes, now this is a little bit tricky, because you see, gate charge is fine, gate is, you know, there, and there is an insulator in between, so it's okay. But if I think about this two-dimensional electron gas, Now, this is kind of like a charge from here to here. So how much of it goes to this and how much of it goes to that? That is a tricky question. Is it 50% source, 50% drain? Is it, I don't know, right? So that is the question which we have to figure out, and we have to make sure that we put it, we model it in the right way. Yeah, so maybe I think this is the right time to take break for 5 minutes, and we start again at 1:05. No, at 10:05.